panel, The Truth About Telling the Truth. I'd like to thank Bieta for putting together such a great panel. Thank the Center of Excellence for this invitation. It's an honor to be here. And I want to introduce our distinguished panelists. To my left is Dainius Radzevicius. Did I pronounce that correctly? Dainius is the chairman of the Lithuanian Journalist Union. To his left is Päivi Anttikoski. Did I get it? I got it. Cool. Excellent. Is the former editor-in-chief for digital content at Helsingin Sanomat. To her left is Dr. Stephen Ward, a distinguished professor lecturer in ethics at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver, Canada. And to his left is John Maguire, director of international relations and cooperation for Radio France Internationale. I just wanted to make a couple of preliminary remarks, broadening the aperture and kind of putting today's discussion in a broader context. In a recent lecture, one of my favorite public intellectuals, the Yale University historian Timothy Snyder, made some comments about post-truth and what this means. And Professor Snyder, in his clever way, said, you know, when we think of post-truth, we tend to think of postmodern Paris, you know, Sartre, and all this kind of cool stuff. But in reality, post-truth is pre-fascism. Post-truth is pre-fascism. When there is no more truth, it's the death of democracy. And I thought about these comments and in thinking about this situation we're in this post-truth world that everybody's talking about, this era of fake news. And it is indeed a challenge to our civilization in a lot of ways. Because the thing that makes civilization possible is our ability to tell stories to each other, to tell intersubjective stories about ourselves. This makes large-scale human cooperation possible, right? I mean, you think of everything from religion to the state to money. I mean, what is money? It's colorful pieces of paper with pictures of dead people on it. But because we all believe that money is worth something, it is worth something. This intersubjective fiction becomes true. Well, the same is true with our democratic institutions. Western civilization has told a story about itself for centuries, based on a bunch of very compelling stories, stories about the rights of the individual, stories about accountable government, stories about the sovereign rights of small states. And there's nothing in our biology that makes these things true. There's nothing in our biology that objectively says we have rights. But we do have rights, because we believe we have rights intersubjectively. We all believe it. What is happening now, what I see happening now, is an outside power, and I don't think we need to name the Russian Federation by name, but I'll do it anyway, which is trying to get us to stop believing in our collective stories about ourselves. And that makes this a very, very dangerous moment, because just like a currency can become devalued, if people stop believing that these colorful little pieces of paper with pictures of dead people on them are worth something and that we could exchange them for stuff, we know what happens to a currency when people stop believing in it. The same thing can happen to our democratic institutions if we stop believing in them. So this is the importance of stories. Now, the place our stories are transmitted is in the media. And so I wanted to start with, for lack of a better term, what I call the bullshit problem. Media has a difficult time. Traditional media, traditional journalism, has a difficult time dealing with bullshit. We're obsessed with balance, right? We're obsessed with balance. We want to tell both sides to the story. But what happens when one side is telling a bald-faced lie? Is the balance somewhere halfway between a lie and a truth? And I wanted to start the discussion by turning it over to Stephen Ward, who has some thoughts on this issue.
Good morning, everyone. I have some slides to show you here, which I believe are coming up. I'm going at the speed of sound here because I have a very short period of time, but I've been asked to give a little overview for our discussion on, yes, bullshit or fake news. The notion of fake news for me is at least part of the discussion of ethics, of journalism ethics as a profession. By definition, the simplest one of journalism ethics is responsible use of the freedom to publish. It includes aims of journalism, the principles, and so on. And for me, there's no journalism ethics in the abstract, some universal absolute that covers all nations. It's relative to culture and context. And in our view, in our Western tradition, it's a liberal democratic view of the media, which has been alluded to. And it's a real question whether that view of liberal democracy is still around and still can be preserved. And so I think Brian's comments are dead on. So where we today, very quickly, we are moving in journalism ethics. I see a fragmentary journalism ethics where a consensus on previous professional values is contested. There's hardly a principle from objectivity onwards that's not contested. From a non-global, pre-digital ethics for professionals to attempt to develop norms for digital global ethic for, here it comes, everyone, not just the professionals. We have a collapse of that consensus, and in fact, we're in search of a new one. Think of it this way. You move from a model up there. You move from a model where the press once were the main collectors and mainstream, and you, as citizens, were dependent upon this professional class that stood between you and the world. Forget it. Doesn't exist. This is the next model. Professionals are still around doing their job. They must share it with many other types of folks and people. So when you say, what can journalism do to fix the bullshit problem, who do you mean by journalists? And you better expand your definition of journalism. Otherwise, the question becomes a little too pinched and tight. At the same time, we have what is called distributed environments, and this has been mentioned yesterday, where people get their information from so many different places that, in fact, do we have a public forum where we can get together as the old theory of democracy used to be? You get together in a forum and you attempt to rationally and factually work out policies. And as a result, the impact on journalism ethics of all these changes is just, I'm not going to go through them, just about everything about journalism ethics as to who is a journalist, to whether in fact there is such a thing as journalism ethics in this new age is there. There are three senses I'm going to put on the table. Fake news. One, factual. This is the old-fashioned one. Fake news just used to be called false. It was just a false report or inaccurate report, and has been the heart of journalism ethics from the beginning. Look at this quote from a London editor, the very first news books coming out in London, 1651. Having put on the armor of resolution, that sounds like a preacher, right? I intend to counter falsehood with the sword of truth. I will not endeavor to flatter the world into a belief of things that are not. Right? Other quote, I present news without any gilded glossings, invented fictions and flattering commentaries. It's all bullshit. The editors of those days were full of flattery and gilded glossings as they are today, but the norms they were doing that was to secure the audience confidence in what they wrote. Secondly, and this is where today I think it's different, when people talk about fake news, it's an ideological sense where it goes against what I believe and what I like to believe in my ideology, so it's fake, I won't listen to it, I'll stay inside my ideological silo and not expose myself to counter-evidence. That, in fact, is what I think is happening in what I call Trumpism in the United States, in which I just left after being there for 8 years. So you have ideologically fractured society, rise of a right-wing populism, which in fact is not just in the United States, empowered by social media, and we get a partisan confrontation, clash of views, and people talk about alternate facts and false facts. Responses in journalism, some say just go back to the old neutral reporters of fact, just double down on that. Others say, no, that's dead, let's all become partisans and let's promote particular political views. I'm more of the third one, which is, no, we need a journalism that is informed, engaged for democracy, but we have to be very critical about what that means. I can explain that later if you wish. And in terms of engagement, I have a variety of things that I can talk about. Dialogic media, spaces for nonpartisan public discourse, a journalism that helps racial and ethnic and economic divides speak across those divides, to explore key democratic ideas and institutional structures and how these have to actually change and adapt to today's global world, actively opposing threats to what I think is the best traditions of liberal democratic journalism, human rights, and so on. Very quickly, we can do a lot. All of these, you could probably add 12 more of those and talk for hours on them. But I do think, first of all, there is a need for to continue to try to strengthen journalism in all parts of the world, particularly in those areas that are dealing with under-resourced or political interference. We've got to help journalists who have been thrown in jail for speaking the truth. We've got to protect human rights and the people human rights are in violation. We have to do all of that. But that takes incredible resources and worldwide coordination. Quality journalism option, yes, more fact-checking, more transparency. I believe the public has to get in on discussions of journalism ethics. It can't be just among journalists anymore. Media literacy embedded in our public educational system. Reorientate journalism schools from toolbox, practical, here's how to do the story, to globally minded citizens and journalists aware of the complexities of the global world they are going into. So knowledge is as important as the very practical skills. Conditions, coalitions, and partnerships with media, I think, are important. Look, here are just some examples. Fact-checking is a huge thing right now, particularly in North America anyway. And here, as you can see in Britain, there's all kinds of organizations, the BBC onward down, who believe that one response, at least, is to sort of try to fact-check the bullshit. Also, you know, you have Reuters with their backstory telling you how, transparency, how did they do their stories? This engenders some sort of trust in it. Enhanced media literacy, Stony Brook in New York State does a lot on news literacy. I think it has to become citizen literacy. It has to be much broader than news literacy, but they have some very good models there to work from. There are new skills on how to verify on the fly, as it were. New techniques and new technology we should be teaching journalists as to how to know whether a particular photo or a particular story actually is true or can be verified at all. 5 years ago, people figured this was totally impossible, but there's almost like arms race here, and people using technology to screw around with the minds of other people, and journalists trying to adopt counter technology on that score. I guess, I think we can collaborate, we can develop new guidelines and ethics to cover a whole range of issues, so on and so forth. I forgot the third sense. Remember, there's a factual sense of the story is just wrong, it's inaccurate. There's the ideological sense is fake news means I don't like it, so it's fake. The third one is mind warfare, which I think is more what I've heard discussed here yesterday, is that information warfare, that in fact fake news is used to enhance political action, including violent terrorist action. So I think that's how I see this fitting in. Journalists' ethics has always cared about truth, and we're in big trouble if we truly are in a post-truth world. Thank you.
Yeah, Stephen, actually, let's stick with you for just a moment, Stephen, because I alluded to this problem of balance, which is something, it's always... Sure. It's something you hear about, we tell both sides of the story as if there are two sides to every story and as if there are only two sides to a story. And I see this as problematic in a lot of ways. I mean, I cite the examples of climate change, for example, where you have 99% of scientists, there's a consensus about this, yet in the name of balance,
right,
you are reporting those who basically deny this is happening. We've seen the same thing happen with evolution.
No, I think all balance, I mean, has to be completely reworked. There are some situations, but only some situations in journalism where the rather strict, what I call quantitative balance of two views is appropriate. You're covering a court case, you've got the prosecution, you've got the defense.
Right.
Fine, you want to get both sides in your story. This was a model taken from political journalism in the early 20th century, where in fact there was liberals and conservatives, Republicans and Democrats, and you sort of shuffle between the two.
Right.
But it totally doesn't work in many other cases. I reported when I was in Newfoundland, I'm Canadian actually, I'm from Canada, as I think was pointed out, and I covered a child abuse molestation at an orphanage of all places by Christian brothers. Now, I didn't try to get the other side saying, who's all for child molestation, right? And treat that as equal in my story. It comes from the values you have as a journalist that some of those are going to be precluded from doing that. What I talk about, but the good thing about balance, the good thing about balance is it's at least inciting you to get another perspective. But what I talk about is a plurality of credible voices in a story. That is an editorial judgment, though. That's not just something. It's much easier to go with the yay and nay. But I have to, as journalists, now decide and know the sources that are coming into my stories. Who are they? How credible are they? How credible are they, is the information they're giving us? So, yeah, I think that that was the old model that we're moving away from, the traditional professional objective model. We're in a new world of engaged, perspectival, more opinionated journalism. And the question now was, what norms? How do we tell a good interpretation from a bad interpretation?
Right. And as this is happening, the business model's changing. As this is happening, we're entering the age of digitalization. As this is happening, algorithms are deciding everything about our lives, from what books I buy to what music I buy to what news I read. And I wonder if Päivi has some thoughts about how the business model is changing and what the implications of that are.
Thank you, Brian. And thank you, Stephen. You put it very well. And good morning, everybody. Did you sleep well? I see some bright faces here. I resigned, like you see, I'm former editor-in-chief of Helsingin Sanomat. I resigned 4 months ago. I wanted to be an outsider and take a good look to media, and it has been very refreshing, I must say. Yeah, today I will talk about two main problems, a little bit data and algorithms as well, but the two main problems of journalism and traditional media. I like to call it traditional media when I talk about the media houses we all know. The other problem is the digitalization itself. At the same time, Brian talked about money. At the same time, when we need more money to make the digitalization of the traditional media, media is struggling with lousy economy, as you all know, and personal cutbacks, and they should put more resources on digital products and new innovations at the same time, both technically, but also in journalism itself and storytelling, which is the key point here. And then the other problem is even more complicated, like we call it here, post-truth era. This morning, I talked with a Swedish friend, a former journalist as well, who's in Almedalen. Do you know, anyone knows here Almedalen Week? It's in Sweden. Yeah, many of you do. It's in Sweden, going on at the moment, lots of discussions and everything. And he told me that only in Almedalen, they have 31 different seminars talking about fake news. So this only tells how difficult and serious this problem is. We journalists like to think that the journalism is the best obtainable version of truth. Best obtainable version of the truth. But this one has been challenged now. And this all has been, we all know, we talked yesterday that this has been going on for a long, long time. And we should have seen it coming, but did we? No, we actually didn't. We did too little, too late. I have to admit. And some of us like to think that this is a problem that will end, that this both, like talking about lack of resources, talking about digitalization, talking about post-truth, that this will end one day. Does it? No, it doesn't. It will go on, but it will move a little bit further. There are new powers coming every day. What there's in the background is a disruption, very used form, disruption of the traditional media. At the same time, while tech giants like Google, Facebook, you know, all those will be even more powerful. And the lack of resources comes from that, the ads from the commercial private media especially don't bring those big revenues anymore. People are not willing to pay of online news. Actually, it's only like people over 50, 60 who are willing to pay nowadays. And selling ad doesn't work actually anymore. And everybody can be a publisher, and it's a freedom of speech as well, I know that, but it's painful sometimes for us journalists. Then about the fake news and the social media part, we are often wondering why people are behaving in social media like they do. Why do they are so nasty and insulting as they do? Yes, last night we heard about, for example, Jessica Aro from Finland talking about her experiences in social media. I think people are doing that because they are scared and they aren't sure. chaos is global, and they don't know what is going to happen for them, and people tend to comfort themselves. If the fact is not good, I'll fix it. I want to hear things that helps me to feel safe and backs up the opinion I have and not challenge me anymore because my life is problematic anyway. And that's not only media who makes like a bubbles around them. We all do that. We want to have some kind of bubble around us. And like I said, that there can always be new Trumps coming to power, new fakes and fake news and new platforms. Then there's a thing called legacy problem. Oh, sorry, I took a wrong slide here. These are a little bit like the same thing what I just said. The only thing is that there's the war of information. I'm briefly talking about that. We do that because it's cheaper and it goes beyond the border. It's more cheaper to troll than buy guns. And also that the states, they can't afford anymore have that many casualties like there is in a real war. An information war is more affecting on spreading fear, and what it like most important is that it goes beyond the borders, like I say. Okay, a little bit about legacy problem, what we talk in media. The legacy problem, do you know what it means? It's like we all traditional media houses, we have the legacy content we have to publish. You know that the print media always have the same pages, like 60 pages to fill. It doesn't matter if it's summer and nothing happens. The newscast, they have like 20 minutes, 30 minutes, and you have to fill that no matter if anything happens. That can lead to, I call it bulk, you guys call it bullshit sometimes also, that people are not interested about that. And what many traditional medias are doing at the moment in digitalization, they are just putting the print to web as PDF. That's not a digitalization. And it's not digitalization or any digital content if you put your like 10 o'clock news to your website as a video. It's not that. Like Brian said, that the story is the most important thing, and you have to be a good storyteller also in web, and those ways are different. They are not the same anymore. And most of the medias at the moment, I have to say, are still filling the pages and the newscast like with whatever. Yesterday, there was a little bit talk about this digital news report published by Reuters Institute, and it's very good, and I really say that you all should read it. It's published every year. They are taking a good look to the whole world and also different countries, like what is happening in media, what is happening to the public, how do they use news. And I found this very interesting, like how many people in all countries at the moment trust in news in general. And you see these figures, like 43% in all countries, 38 in USA. And that's, I think, it's devastating. But the one question what I like to point out more is that the first time it was asked, like, are you avoiding the news on purpose? And look at the figures. 29 people, like a third of everyone, are avoiding the news just on purpose, and 38% in the USA. And I guess one of the points is, you all know this, it's the modern day things. This is more interesting. It's modern, it draws attention, it raises up feelings, and the stories, they do need feelings. Then I have a few examples. I try to be brief because Brian wanted us to be brief, sorry. I have a few examples of the power of the social media. Some of you here might know who this guy is. He's Mr. Jussi Halla-aho. He's a member of Europarliament, and he's the new chairman of the True Finns Party. I think this party might be more familiar with some of you. In Finland, it's a right-wing, populist, nationalist-oriented Finnish political party. Jussi Halla-aho was just elected as a new chairman of the party. And many thought that the winner would be Mr. Sampo Terho, who belongs to the party elite, and he's also a minister and everything. And he had a big campaign on the spot. And they were giving out gifts and materials and everything, and he was the succeeder. But Jussi Halla-aho didn't have a campaign at all there on spot or anything, nothing visible, nothing was shown. But still, he won. And then it came out later that he had a big campaign on Facebook, on closed groups. They were close, so they could count all the single persons who were voting for Mr. Jussi Halla-aho, and they know exactly that he's going to win. And what this did, when he won, the whole party was divided in two, and it caused almost a collapse of the Finnish government a few weeks ago. So don't underestimate the power of social media. And Halla-aho also, he has built a strong profile only in social media. He leads the party mostly in social media. He published his, for example, speeches in YouTube mainly. He doesn't like to speak in public. Okay, then I'm introducing you a much nicer person. This is my son. He's 9 years and he's having his holiday there. You can see that. But though he's 9 years, he's very interested in news. For example, Trump, he reads a lot about that, terrorism, even the Finnish politics. And he likes to read the news. And now I would like to introduce you one more person, and this is the primary source, news source of my son. This guy is called Ronnie Back. He's a YouTube star, Finnish YouTube star, not a trained journalist. But he has, in Finland, he has over 254,000 followers. And if you bear in mind that we Finns are 5.5 million and we only have this weird language nobody else understands, so this is a lot of followers. And also, he's publishing a new news video every single day and get like 100,000 views in one day. And that's a lot. And this guy is primary news source for many in Finland, for among the young Finns. I'm not talking about like 9 years old, I'm talking about teenagers, I'm talking about the young, like over 20 and so on. And they are having their news from them. Luckily, Ronnie Back, I've met him and I talk with him, like how did he decide to publish news? And he said that because it's fun. Luckily, he's very responsible and he checks his sources and everything, but like I said, not trained journalist. So there are a few lessons to learn from social media. If you can't beat them, make the most out of them. Try to learn, like tell the stories like they do in social media. And the old media package doesn't work anymore. Think about Tinder. I'm not asking like how many of you are in Tinder. I could ask like how many of you play Counter-Strike or something like that. But think about them. Tinder is creating very good relationships. Counter-Strike makes you play and play again, and then there's like Twitter who combines new sources and allows you to be interactive. In marketing, they say that if you want to reach all the Muslim girls in East London, use the Muslim girls in East London. That works there. Could it also work in journalism? I've seen many cases that it does. You also could give the voice to the people who are experiencing the things. Get out from the bubble. But then again, you have to think this, that in digital news report, over half of the people don't believe the news or the facts coming from social media. And only 20% is thinking that Facebook, for example, is a good source for media. One more person, I promise. Any Danes here? One, you know this guy? No. Kasper Klünge? Sounds Danish. Sounds Danish, yeah, he is Danish actually. He is the new digital ambassador of Denmark, the first digital ambassador in the whole world. And he's an actual diplomat serving in Indonesia now. Now you know. And he's going to move to Silicon Valley in the 1st of September to start, you know, to combine the diplomatic world to tech world. And why is he doing that? Because in Denmark, you think like this. Anders Samuelsen, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Denmark, has said, these companies have become a new kind of nation, and we need to address that. These companies influence Denmark as much as other nations do. It's a new reality. Think about that. In Denmark, they think they compare tech giants as a nations. And that is really something to think. I already got these. But this is the one thing that I like to use. In society, usually the product is good when the client is happy. But in journalism, the product is good when the journalist herself is happy. And that is something we have to change. One more slide. This is the bright side of the thing. Maybe we, at the moment, we soon will reach the bottom. Because, like talked yesterday, for example, people are getting bored, really bored about fake news sometime. And, for example, in this digital report, it has said that something has to be done to restore the trust, confidence and fortune. And you see these figures, like how many new digital subscribers these medias have got after Trump was elected. And that gives some hope. And there's also figures about how many people are paying about the online news. And we, in Scandinavia, we are in good positions because like 25-24% are paying. But for example, in UK, Greece, only 60%. Thanks.
Thank you, Päivi.
And, a bit long,
I admit. It's not only Finns that understand your language, the Estonians, as I understand it as well. So it's not that funny language.
Actually, there are many Estonians here. It's not that easy. We know that.
But moving now to Lithuania, and I, Dainius, I know you are concerned in this environment that Päivi just described for us, right, where entertainment is competing with the news, and journalists have to compete with entertainers to keep the attention of the public. I know this is something that you're quite concerned with, so take the floor and tell us what is bothering you.
Thank you, Brian. Where's my presentation? Okay, I guess I have one presentation, but maybe later. Good morning, guys. How many journalists we have here? Very few. Thank you. Since yesterday, I can read a lot of messages from this conference, and actually, it seems for me we have a lot of investments into this conference and to a strategy of communication of this conference also. And I would start with some facts related to real journalism in real life, you know. In Lithuania, for example, we have in each biggest newspapers, news portals and televisions, very few journalists who are interested in investigative journalists. Usually they have one or two persons. Sometimes in some newsrooms we have like five persons. But each division of PR, of ministries, municipalities, they have even more people who are caring about strategy of communication. It means we have so many people who are investing time, money, everything to communication and strategy of communication. We have a lot of stories, a lot of truths, and we have very few journalists who has no time to investigate or at least to check the facts. In our country, and also I guess in many countries which has still problems with journalism, we are discussing about some solutions, but nobody are discussing about investments. We are still cutting working places in media, but on our side, we have countries like Russia, for example, who invest billions of euros or dollars in the machines of propaganda. And we have competition not between entertainment and journalism. We have competition between journalists who are still dealing somehow with truth and facts, and most of people who are interested in a very aggressive way of communication. Countries, international and national companies, even governmental institutions, they are trying to tell their own story every day. They are bombing journalists and newsrooms with a lot of press releases, YouTube channels, Twitter messages, every day, thousands and thousands of so-called news. And during this conference, we are discussing about challenges for journalists and challenges for a future of a true. But the challenge is only one. Who are interested, actually, from us in a true? Many of us are dealing with own strategy and own communication. Most of the international organizations of journalists, IFJ, UFJ, also international organizations like OSCE, we are discussing nowadays not about investments in a journalist, in the quality of journalists. We are discussing about safety of journalists, security of journalists. We are dealing with some specific social group of society, which I call minority. We are really minority. And during this conference, we are discussing also about role of media, role of journalists during the war or information war. What kind of role? Nobody are caring about conditions of journalists, working conditions, social security issues, investment in the conditions. Most of journalists has no chance to attend events like this for 2 days, just to cover what's happened here. They can watch actually sometimes on a Facebook somewhere, but they actually have no time to check all these facts and all these messages of us. Most of journalists, they leave newsrooms and media. For example, last week, I got a message from two biggest news portal and two journalists who was very good in journalism. They said, bye-bye, guys. One of them now will work for prime minister as advisor. Second one will work for Social Democrats Party. And we have younger journalists every day who has no experience, no chance to check facts, to attend events, seminars, conferences, because every media companies, normal media companies, I mean public broadcasters or commercial, they cut working places every day. But countries like Russia, for example, they still invest. And we compete with different understanding of journalism. In Western part of Europe and Lithuania also, we still are thinking about some profession which must be somehow protected, somehow, no idea how. And in Eastern part, we have guys who know very well that journalism can be a tool. Okay, not journalism, media and so-called journalists. And they invest billions of euros or dollars and are saying for us, we need to care about journalists also in countries like Russia, for example. And we have a lot of platforms, for example, nowadays, discussing about safety of journalists, even journalists, so-called journalists who work for propaganda machine, for example, in Ukraine, how we can protect if person who defines himself as a journalist. And nowadays, I would say we have the biggest challenge not to define who is journalist or who is propaganda. It's not a problem. The problem is who really needs a true information. Very honest, my colleagues told about young generation and kids. I have also 4 kids. They are interested actually in some kind of information, but more related to personal interest. Nobody are dealing with two sides, or let's say with three sides or different opinions. They need opinion which they like. That's why, coming back to our discussion, let's talk not about security of journalists or protection of journalists. Let's speak about investment in journalism. It will be better. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dainius. Well, we've been hearing a lot about what's wrong, right? And a lot about what's wrong in the current situation. And now I wanted to turn to John Maguire, because John works for a public broadcaster. And this, in some ways, allows opportunities to find creative ways to get the story out. So I wanted John to tell us some of those creative ways that he's been experiencing working on.
For us as public broadcasters, international public broadcasters, truth is literally a matter of life or death. We have already lost journalists on the field. I'll maybe talk about that later. I'm John Maguire, Director of International Relations of France Media Monde. France Media Monde is publicly funded by France. It's the French international broadcaster organization, which has three brands, France 24, France 24 Television, broadcasting in French, Arabic, and English, Radio France Internationale, RFI, broadcasting in 15 languages, including French, and importantly for my talk, an Arabic language radio called Monte Carlo Dualia, and for those of you who are not Arabic speakers, Dualia means international. The advantage that we have, I think, is that unlike private broadcasters, we have a certain leeway when it comes to creativity and facing the challenges that we have in this ever-evolving world. One of the functions of myself and my team is to try to break down the silos within the company. There's a cooperation element both within the company and externally. Within the company, we try to break down the silos, and it's not just a gimmick. Everybody talks about breaking silos and making people work across the board. For us, it's extremely important, for example, in the field of cybersecurity in which I work, along with the technical department. I also work with the security people on in ensuring the security of our people on the ground. But what I want to talk to you today is about how we work to get more outreach to people who would not be able to be got in touch with through traditional or legacy methods. And I'm including that, television, radio, whatever. And I want to talk about one target audience that we had particularly in our sights, related to the news, because we are reactive to the news, obviously. We're reactive to what's happening in the world. And in 2015, I should stress that ourselves, France Media Monde, and our German friends, Deutsche Welle, have a very strong working relationship, and the heads, the CEOs of both companies get together quite regularly. And in June 2015, they had a meeting, and I was at the meeting. The two of them, Marie-Christine Saragosse from France Media Monde and Peter Lindbergh from Deutsche Welle, met in Paris routinely in June 2015, and the conversation inevitably came around to the migrant situation, which was all over the news. And we talked among ourselves, we thought, what are we going to do? But the two heads of company said, okay, go and work on a project, come back to us with the project and see what happens. I happened to be on holiday myself in Izmir on my way to Çeşme for a bourgeois holiday, if you like, and I was completely struck by the squalor on the streets of Izmir, the total destitution of people waiting in queues, waiting to be exploited, basically. But I was also struck by the use of mobile phones. Everybody, despite how poor they were and how destitute they were, they had mobile phones. So I got back to my team, we knocked our heads together, talked to our German colleagues, and came up with a project, which was to be interactive using mobile phone technology, using new technology, Facebook, Twitter, etc. And then the idea evolved that we would actually have a site. So we worked on a project over a few months, realized that two companies were not sufficient for this, because the caveat that was expressed by the two bosses of the two companies was, we're not giving you any money for this. That's another aspect of my work. We find the money. So we went cap in hand to the European Commission, which is normally moves along at a snail's pace when you answer a tender, you answer a call for tender for a development project, for example. They were extremely open to fast-tracking the whole thing, but they said, look, we want more partners, and we want this, that, and the other. So the other partner that we got on board was ANSA, the Italian news agency, for obvious reasons, because a lot of migrants go through Lampedusa, etc. And then we came across a very, very, very good report by the Open University in England, which was called Mapping Refugee Media Journeys, Smartphones and Social Networks, which was published by them in May 2016. So we decided to ask them on board as well as a minor partner in order to monitor our work every month with the migrants to see where we're hitting target, where we doing the right thing. The concept of the site and the social media effort is interactive. It's not obviously to encourage migrants to come. It's not to discourage them to come. It's to give them news, really accurate news about what's happening. For example, Today, we would have the European Union being slammed by Amnesty International about a dirty deal supposedly being made by the European Union and the Libyans. Yesterday, it would have been the 50 people drowned off the coast of Morocco in a rubber dinghy. That would be our news section. I'll show you that in a second on the website page. But it's also an interactive thing. It's giving the people a voice. It's allowing them information, to have access to information about what to do when they find themselves in situations where they can't speak a language, where they don't know the rules of the country, where there are certain social mores, for example, regarding gender, that they need to know about. And also, and crucially, it was aimed at avoiding the whole human trafficking issue. Because, as you know, the child pedophilia, child trafficking, the whole works is happening. So it was to sensitize the people who would be potential or actual migrants about how to actually stay sane. So, Vladis, would you like to show the trailer, please? It's an English language trailer. We have, obviously, the main content or the main thrust of what we do is in Arabic, which is why I stress Monte Carlo d'Oelia, but and François Quatre, which is also in Arabic. But we have an English version too. So could you please throw the video, please?
In recent years, the world has witnessed an unprecedented migrant crisis. Thousands have arrived on the doorstep of Europe, fleeing poverty and violence, seeking a better future, risking their lives. Relying essentially on mobile phones for information, migrants often fall victim to lies spread on social media or by smugglers and human trafficking networks. Conscious of the unfolding tragedy, three European media companies, France Media Monde, Germany's Deutsche Welle, and the Italian press agency ANSA, have joined forces around their area of expertise, information. With co-financing from the EU, a new site has been launched, Info Migrants. Available in three languages, French, English, and Arabic, and on all platforms, Info Migrants is a joint project. The main objective, shared by France Media Monde, Deutsche Welle and ANSA, is to provide reliable information to migrants wherever they may be, in their native country, on the road, or in the country they hope to build a new life.
Now, as I said, the European Commission funded this. Structurally, we hired five journalists, and they're set up in France Media Monde, right beside where I work, in my area of the building. There are feeds, editorial feeds coming every day from both Italy and Germany, Deutsche Welle and ANSA. And then the small editorial team of five people that we employed using European Commission funds, they put the thing together. And as I said, it's multi-platform video, whatever. This is the, have we got it on screen? Yes. This is the, it's not the actual today's homepage, but this is a homepage, just to give you an idea. I'm going to scroll down, if I can. There you go. So you've got a top story. You've got the top stories, and as you see, you've got a German input, the football one. You've got Italy, Guinea, and you've also got another Germany thing. Fact check, is it easy to find jobs in Germany? The next thing we have are features, and you'll see these are Deutsche Welle features, as it happens. So it's not always the case. And then we have news, the daily refugee news roundup. You'll see there's an Italy-Libya story there. And then personal stories. This is the interactive part to allow migrants to actually tell their stories. And that way we communicate with the would-be or actual migrants through the voices of other people who have gone through the experiences. And then there's a section on the page called Understanding Europe. For example, Italy, how to ship rescue refugees stranded at sea. Italy, Tarimli app to help migrants with translation. And Greece's asylum policy explained. And then at the bottom, there's an area on the European Union. The middle one, obviously, is the European Union a country or a city? You know, they need to know what the European Union is. And then there are life stories or experiences. I'm going to leave you with another short video, and then if you have questions, we can get back to that later.
Mm-hmm. መጻሐፍ ወታ ሀገር ኤርትራ ማለት ነው መጀመር ሳካብ ኤርትራ ወጻይ ማለት ነው ሀብ አደይ ነጽነት ስለዚህ ነው ቅስን ካሰራህት ከነ ፖለቲካ ካውድማ ቅስን አሰራ ስለዚህ ካልኩ በቃ አደይ ሀዲገን ሱዳን ነጽ መጀመር ኤርፓ ማለት ነው በሱዳን ስደት ማለት ነው ካውን ሰሃራ ሊቢያ ካብ ሊቢያ በባህር ገረ ኢታሊያ አቴ ካብ ኢታሊያ ድህሪ 4 ወርህን ፖርቱጋል መጽ ሊቢያ ማለት ነው አመንገዲ ብዙህ ግፍ እየ ማለት እንደ ክርስቲያ አብ ህይወትና ብዙህ ግፍ እየ ብዙህ ስቃያት ብዙህ መከራ ሪና እና ዘበጽና ወ ገንዘብ ተከፍል ብዙህ መከራ ማለት ህይወትና ሊቢያ ተመለስ ካዘክሮ خلاص አስካካ ከዘፋን ህይወት ህልፍና እና ዘበጽና ተዛሐለፍና ህይወት ለነዘክሮስ ወላ ንጽላ ከዚህ ምን ጽተም ተርፈህ ዋታይ ስበዛ አነ ዘሐለፍ በህይወት ከሐልፉ ሳይደደኔ በቃ አነ ቅብሎም ዝኸል በጣም ህይወት ህማ ስለዘኾነስ በኦ ህይወትሰብ ኢትዮጵያ ለመጀመር 1915 ገበርና ማለት ኢትራን ጀመንተን ሀገራት ወድ በህብረት ሀገራት ወዛሁም ስለዛውን አምሉ ዓለም ያሽራ ጌርና ካኡ ተጸቢሃ ብሽድሽዴ ሹዓተ ወርሖም ተሰልጣና ንግሮምና አሽራ ጌርና ኢንተርቪው ጌርና በትናተ ምሐገ ክንከይ ኢድና ስለዛሁምና ኦቆፊና ተጸቢና በትናተ ምሐገ ፖርቱጋል በጽህኒ ተቀቢለ ፈሪም ሐራይ ረመጽ ቦጌርና ወራአቱን ፈሐቢልና ናምሉ ሀገራት ፈሐክና ብለኩምና ተዘለና ሐራይና ተቀቢልና ዮ ተናሰም ሀቂ አሽራ ኢንተርቪው ጌርና ጉቡና ንጽፈኔርና ወራጥና ናቤና ሀገር ከመስከደ በብናቱ ሀዋነ ፖርቱጋል በጽፍክ ስለዝበሉኒ ትሕግኩሉ አነ ጊሮምኒ ፖርቱጋል ከምዝንከም ዝንዝንዝ መሰላ ለከ አመት ሽድ ሸወርህን ኩሉ ትሕጊ አማሊዮ ማለት ይገልጸምኒ ካውን ፖርቱጋል ነጽ
Uma delas vinha grávida, eu fiz todo o acompanhamento às consultas de monitorização da gravidez. Também aproveito para informar que também damos alimentação, damos sempre um cabaz de alimentos todos os meses, com também produtos de higiene, roupa e fraldas para as bebês. Quanto à casa, elas estão numa casa, mas agora vão mudar para outra com melhores condições e maior, que se adequa ao agregado familiar.
بزح جزء قبر كوجن مستقل عام مستقل عقبه يعرف كل مرات نفسي.
They make an effort to integrate, and Portuguese is very important. They also work in part time, and they are trying to get friends in Portuguese. We receive all them with our arms open.
ፖርቱጋል በጣም ተመጣጣብለም ነው መስኩነም ተሐበባረም በጣም ፖርቱጋል ሲ መግለጽ ከብለም በጣም ተመጣጣብ አብይታል ማለት ነው ፖርቱጋል ታ ፖርቱጋል እንደያ ፖርቱጋላዊ ያጋለይ አምስቲያ ነው ፖርቱጋላዊ መሐናበል መደበይን መጻፍ ፖርቱጋል ተማሄረ ከሰረ ደቀይን ሀዳራይን ጋ በሐንሳ ማለት ነው ህላውነትና ነሐረጋግጽ ማለት ነው ኢዴ ስለዛብ ኩሉ ለውነቴ ንመጻ ተማህረስ ከሰረ ጽቆ ህይወት ከመረ ተስፈልን
So that is just one example of the video material that we post on the site. Just a final word about how we actually get this message across. Maybe that's a question that has crossed your mind. A lot of it is word of mouth. A lot of it is lobbying, embassies, diplomatic representations, ONG organizations, both in the camps and outside of the camps. As well as that, we hand out flyers to people. We have launches. The last launch we had was in Beirut, in Lebanon, last month, because obviously Beirut and Lebanon in general has a huge refugee crisis problem, and so it was an ideal place to do one of the launches in Arabic. I've got brochures, not a lot of them, and I've got stickers and flyers. I would really appreciate it if you yourselves would access the site, have a look, and if you're interested, please pass on the information. That's just one of the things that we do in France Media Monde. But I wanted to focus on that because it's such an issue at the moment. And if we can't get the true stories across to these poor people. They're going to be completely manipulated by cynical, as we say in French, passeurs, human traffickers. So thank you very much.